हेलो। ओके, वेलकम एवरीवन टू द सेकेंड लेक्चर ऑन मेटल सेमीकंडक्टर जंक्शंस। टुडे वी विल लुक इनटू द फीचर्स of the ideal ohmic contacts which we can use as terminal contacts in our ICs. Okay, so in our previous lecture we had already completed these two topics, like the Schottky mod theory and the rectifying contacts concept. So let's just recapitulate a little bit. So we began with the situation between the metal and an n-silicon in such a way that the metal work function phi m is greater than the theoretical silicon work function phi si. Why is it theoretical? We all know that this EF is in the within the band gap, so essentially you are not going to have any energy states at EF. And by definition, how do you define work function? That is the energy required to pull an electron from that Fermi energy level to the vacuum level, correct? So in case of the metal, the EFM has got electrons. In case of silicon or semiconductors, EF does not have electrons. Okay, that's why I'm calling it like the work function as a theoretical one, not the practical work function. You cannot, technically it is not accurate. On the contrary, you can have a parameter called the electron affinity, because electrons can be present at the conduction band edge. Okay, so the amount of energy to pull an electron from the conduction band edge to the vacuum level is electron affinity xi silicon. Correct? Basic definitions. So now, if phi m is greater than phi si, okay, as you can see that phi m is from here to there, phi si is from here to there. So that means phi m is larger than phi si. Under this condition, when we are making, these are the isolated diagrams, so that basically there is a lot of space between the two. When you are making a contact, what happens? Fermi energy level will always align themselves, okay, because it is contact under thermal equilibrium. Whenever I say equilibrium, remember it is always thermal, even if I don't write it. Remember those concepts, like thermal energy is the only energy, heat energy, that is only energy that does not disrupt equilibrium, unless you are maintaining a difference in the heat content. Otherwise, if it is uniform heat distribution, it's always going to be under thermal equilibrium. Okay, so under the thermal equilibrium, what is going to happen? EF is going to align with EFM. EF is for the silicon, n-silicon. EFM is for the metal. Nice. So once we are aligning this, clearly the when x is much further away from the interface, we are going to have the same relative distance between EC, EF and EV, the way it is here. As you can see, the same relative distance is being followed over here. However, at the interface, we are going to have the same level of EC. So that means if this is your EC, okay, if this is your EC level, this is the same EC level we are speaking about. Okay, why is that? Because the vacuum level has to always be under, it should be continuous. Okay, so as you can see, the energy bands should be continuous. So here, energy levels should be continuous. So vacuum level is kind of. It has to, so it cannot be like vacuum level here and suddenly it is starting from there. No, this discontinuity is not possible. So that's the reason why your EC, EI, and EV are always going to be like that. Okay, so the EC, EI, and EV values at the interface will be the same as in the case of an isolated material. However, this a little bit distance away from the interface, it is going to be such that it is having the same separation from EC, EV, and EF. Okay, so the difference between the EC at the interface and the EC at let's say x equal to infinity is the VBI. Okay, that's the built-in potential seen on the semiconductor side. Okay, as you can see, the electrons which are coming from this end, okay, the electrons which are coming from this end, it is going to see a barrier of height, this VBI, the red one. Whereas the electrons which are coming from this end, and the electrons which are coming from this end, they will essentially find a barrier of height phi bi. Okay. So what is the difference here? If you notice that this phi bi, and so just for comparison sake, I have essentially drawn this right hand side material, isolated version, over here in the sky blue color, cyan color. So what we understand is that with respect to the same vacuum level, what do we understand? That VBI is equal to, from here to there is EFM, the same level is here, and from the vacuum level to EF is here. So the difference between the two Fermi energy levels, so EF and EFM, this difference is essentially the VBI, so phi m minus phi si. Okay, then what is phi bi? If you notice, phi bi is here, EFM, and here what is this state? This is basically the EC value. So EC from vacuum level, what is that? Xi silicon. So xi silicon and phi m ka difference. So that means phi m minus xi silicon. Okay, so what do you also understand is that phi bi, this phi bi can also be written as this VBI plus EC minus EF by Q, okay, this part. So this is basically a relation between the phi bi and VBI. So what do we understand? That if we essentially, excuse me, if we essentially ensure that this EC and EF distance is reduced, notice, if we reduce the separation between the EC and EF, then VBI and phi bi will remain this, will become the same. Okay. So how can you do that? How can you do that? How can you ensure that EF will essentially rise up to EC?
Doping.
Doping, very good. So if you are doping the material, EF will gradually move towards EC. And if you have doped it very, very high, what can happen? EF and EC will come, become the same, right? So your new semiconductor junction will be something like this, right? Semiconductor and metal junction. So effectively, what we understand is that it starts behaving like a polysilicon. You have learned about polysilicon, right? So in case if you are having a polysilicon, then effectively you are getting one kind of roughly like a metal only. Okay, we will look into this later on when we talk about ohmic junction. I mean, ideal contact. So just keep that thought in mind. So that is the reason why I wrote it over here. So as we dope the semiconductor material, this EF and EC will become the same. So this will cancel out. You are left with VBI equal to phi bi. Okay. Okay. So now this is essentially the situation for the Schottky-Mott theory. Then we will come to the concept of rectifying contacts. Okay. So if you are trying to talk about rectifying, this word rectifying, I elaborated a lot about that in our previous lecture. Why is it a rectifying contact? Rectifying contact is nothing but a diode, okay? Very simple. That means a diode does rectification in circuits. So all kinds of rectifying circuits are done using diodes mostly. So essentially, if you are talking about rectifying contact, means it's a simple PN junction diode. Not PN junction, just a diode, okay? So if you want to make a rectifying contact with using metal and semiconductor, these contacts are called Schottky barrier diodes or Schottky barriers, simple. So what we'll do, I have simply copied this blue, this dark blue diagram, I have just copied it over here because this is under thermal equilibrium, okay? So now what we are going to do is, if you apply biases, okay? So suppose we have applied a forward bias. Okay. forward bias meaning, what is the basic fundamental concept of forward bias? You are effectively reducing the barrier depletion width. Okay, so depletion width means this band bending should reduce. Makes sense? So look at the chain of thoughts. First of all, you will apply a bias which has to reduce this band bending. Therefore, the depletion width will reduce. That is basically the idea about forward biasing. So if this band bending is reduced, look at this situation here. The band bending is reduced. So what happens is, even though your EF, under thermal equilibrium, EF and EFM, the metal part and the semiconductor part were aligned. Now, if you are applying a forward bias, what happens is, you have to push this EF above. Okay, so if you have to push EF above, so what does it imply? Think about it. Your EF was earlier aligned with EFM, as you can see here. Okay, this was the same alignment. EFM and EF were aligned. So this is the level. So now what we understand is you have simply pushed this EF from this lower green level to the higher green level. Okay, so what does it imply? What is the voltage you have to apply on the semiconductor side?
Negative voltage.
Where are you applying negative voltage?
On the semiconductors.
No, N-type silicon. N. Semiconductor, definitely. So this is N-type. So basically, if you are applying N negative bias to the N-type material, is it forward bias or reverse bias? Forward bias. Correct? So now you understand is that it is basically coming to the same basic theory of diodes, simple diodes. So you are, if you want to forward a PN junction, what do? You either apply a positive to the P type or you apply a negative to the N type. So it's basically we are doing the same thing. Okay. So now what is the situation? If you have applied here minus VF, you have applied negative bias on this N type silicon. So it is forward biased. This minus VF simply adds up to the VBI. So basically it becomes VBI plus whatever voltage you are applying. So it is minus VF in this case. Okay. So what it means is you are essentially reducing the VBI, that is a built-in potential on the semiconductor side. So this is very important. The barrier height seen from the metal remains unchanged. Okay. On the contrary, if you're applying a forward bias by VF, what happens is the barrier height for the electrons on the silicon side or semiconductor side is reduced. So VBI decreases by VF. Got it, everybody? Very good. Now, if we are going by the reverse bias, what is the situation? We are going to increase the band bending. Therefore, increase the depletion width also. So if you want to increase the band bending, I should write it differently. So in this case, here is the W depth, which is reduced. And in this case, this is your W depth. Okay, so W depth is increased because of the band bend. This diagram is not okay. Maybe. Okay. So now, so if you are applying a reverse bias of VR, the whole objective is to increase the band bending. So band bending increasing means W depth will increase, as you can see here. So in this case, if you want to increase the band bending, what you have to do is you have to push the EF downwards. Okay. Again, let us check this out. Previously, EF was aligned with this over here. Now it is pushed below. Previously it was pushed up from here to there. Now it is pushed down. Okay. So if you are pushing it down, what is the voltage which you will apply? plus Vr. You know, because this is energy. This is energy. Y-axis is energy. So it will always go in the reverse direction. So if you are applying a plus Vr, on which side are you applying the plus Vr? N silicon. So you're applying a positive bias on the N-type material. So it's becoming a reverse bias. Got it, everybody? Excellent. Okay. So again, the same story. The built-in potential seen by the electron when it is transferring from the metal to the semiconductor, it is going to find the same barrier. It remains unchanged, unaffected. Whereas the barrier height seen from the semiconductor size has increased. Okay. Very good. Fine. So this is a situation for for the rectifying contact. All right. So now we will come to the non-rectifying contact situation. Okay. In some textbooks, they say that non-rectifying contacts are also ohmic contact. Many of you might be thinking like that, but it is a very poor quality terminal. Okay, we are not going to look into it. So in modern technology, the specific contact resistance should be less than 10 power minus 4 ohm centimeter square. This is specific resistivity, of course. Okay, so now what we realize is we are not going to have this 10 power minus, we are not going to achieve this kind of 10 power minus 4 ohm centimeter square if we are going for this non-rectifying contact. Okay, we will look into this. So in this case, what we shall do is a poor, here, let us begin with the situation where the isolated band diagrams are shown over here, in which the metal and the semiconductor, metal and the silicon part, what we realize is this xisilicon and phi si. Okay, xisilicon and phi si, this is phi m. Here, phi m is less than phi si. Here, earlier, what was the situation? Phi m was greater than phi si. That's why I put it in red color. This is very important. Okay, so if we are putting phi m less than phi si, look at this. So here is a vacuum level. You are essentially having, this is from here to there is the EFM, the phi m. And from the same vacuum level to EF is here. But note, we are using the same N silicon here. Okay, so if you are choosing N silicon and phi m less than phi si, you will have a scenario like this. Now, if we make a contact, what is going to happen? Clearly, EFM and EF will align themselves. EFM and EF are aligning themselves. Very nice. Then what is the situation? As usual, further away from the interface, the relative distance between EC, EF, and EF and EV remains the same. Nice. EC, EF, and EC and EV remain the same further away from the surface. Further away means how much further away? Beyond the depletion region. However, in this case, we will not call it depletion region. Beyond the band bending region is a better word, because this will actually behave like an accumulation region. Okay. Notice, why is it an accumulation region, not a depletion one? In this case, we had seen that in our previous lecture, if you are putting it like this, so EF is here. So the distance between the EC and EF has increased over here. So the region over here is essentially becoming more and more, I mean, less and less p-type, less and less n-type, sorry, in this case, less and less n-type than the bulk. In this case, however, what is going to happen? If there is a band bending like this, EF is becoming closer to EC. If you notice the way I have drawn it, EC is almost at EF on the surface, right, on the interface. So as a consequence, what is happening? That EF, so the surface is more n-type than the bulk is n-type. Here, what was the situation? The surface was less n-type than the bulk is n-type. So that means it was a depletion region. That's why we wrote here WD, W depth. That's why this behavior is similar to the diode. Schottky barrier diode. In this case, it is becoming more n-type. Okay, so that means it is behaving like more accumulation region. So let's just write it like this. So lot of electrons here, less of electrons here. So this is n-type, this is n-plus kind of thing. More electrons are there. So what will happen? These electrons will nicely flow into the metal. Okay, so this will essentially behave like an ohmic contact, but still it is not that great. We will understand why. You can consider this as a terminal contact, but it is a poor quality terminal. Okay, now let us come to the practical ohmic contacts. Okay, this is the main, most important part of this entire lecture. So we have also done this. Okay, so here, let us look into it. The first approach, as we have already understood, is the one which we have seen, non-rectifying contacts. But these are poor quality, we will see this. Choose the materials, that metal and semiconductor materials should be chosen such that the phi m should be less than phi si. I'm calling it semiconductor means silicon over here, okay? So phi m should be less than phi si for terminals over nsi, the way I have shown it over here. Agar aap n silicon, n type material, n type silicon ke upar agar aap contact banana chahte ho, then you have to choose the metal such that phi m is less than phi si. Very, very important concept. In the interviews, it is a patent question. So now let us look into that n plus, get this. So if you want to make a contact over the source and the drain region, what kind of metal will you choose? There are contacts, right? So source and the drain terminal ka contact jab banana hai, then what will you choose? You have to choose phi m less than phi si. But there is a better way of doing it. But in approach one, whatever we have learned, the most primitive way of doing it is like that. Okay, because it is n plus region, as you can see here, I have shown that EC is almost close to EF now. So that means this is n plus. So this is n plus and the metal will be EFM. So when is this contact possible? When you are choosing phi m less than phi si. So this is the most practical part of these two lectures which we have been doing for the last couple of days. So phi m should be less than phi si. Got it? And what does this phi si depend on? Clearly, xi silicon plus EC minus EF by Q. Correct? EC minus, so dekho, phi si kya hai? Phi si is all the way. So xi silicon plus EC minus EF by Q, this much part. Okay. So what is this much part? This will be EC minus EF by Q will be EG by 2Q. Remember, this whole thing is how much? Half of the band gap. Okay. So here, instead of this, this implies phi m should be less than xi silicon plus EG by 2Q. Here I'll put a Q because this is written in the potential terms. Here I'll remove that Q because these are all in energy. Okay. Minus how much? Yahan se yahan tak kitna hai? EF minus EI? 5F. Got it? So that means, what is this 5F again? Pi T ln ND by NI. Okay. So this will essentially depend on the doping of the N plus region. So depending on the doping of the N plus region, you have to remember that what is the doping of the N plus region. Accordingly, you have to choose this metal which will have a phi m which is given by this relation. Understood? This is a very, very important concept, but somehow missed in most of the textbooks. Okay, konsa metal choose karna hai? When we say it is aluminum, ya fir molybdenum, or whatever metal. So many metals are there in the periodic table, right? Which one will you choose given by this fundamental model? Okay. So I am not going into the mathematics of it because it doesn't matter as long as phi m is less than this particular term. Okay, so if I ask you, if anybody asks you in interview, like, okay, I have doped this n plus is doped as 10 power 20 per centimeter cube. Okay, then how, what is the metal will you choose? आपको जाई सिलिकॉन पता है, you know that value of जाई सिलिकॉन from, I mean, you already know that 4.05 electron volt at room temperature. Then Eg, you know, 1.12 electron volt at room temperature. Ni, you know, 10 to the power of 10, 1.45 into 10 power of 10 per centimeter cube at room temperature. Phi t, you know, 0.026 milli electron volt, 0.026 electron volt, sorry. That also you know. So only thing that you do not know, or that should be provided in the question, is basically this. Okay, so if you do the calculation, you will get the right-hand side. So you have to choose a metal which is whose work function is less than that. Then all you have to do is you open up the periodic table and find out which metal is there. Then but you will essentially get a many metals which will essentially have multiple metals which essentially will have the phi m, that is a work function which is less than that. The trouble is you cannot use all the any of the metals just arbitrarily, because it will depend on whether the metals are soluble or not, whether the metals are okay for fabrication or not, and then cost is also comes into the picture. Okay, so those are all process related issues. But from the physics related concerns, for example, PMMD level concerns, you have to essentially ensure that this is true. Okay, but this is only the first approach. Now we will come to the second approach, which is a better one. This approach one was the, I mean, oldest technology, but so that we will use the non-rectifying contact. Many people call this as the contact, but actually, no, this is not good enough. Because for a practical ohmic contact, which you can literally use for designing ICs, so for good quality terminals, you have to always ensure that the contact resistance must be negligibly small compared to the semiconductor specimen. Okay, so notice that there is a semiconductor specimen over here, isolated one. Iska kuch inherent resistance hoga, which is definitely going to be much larger than the metal. Metal resistance is much less, like, right? So silicon ka, I mean, it will be in say kilo ohms, and in case of metals it will be point something ohms. So if you make a contact, you have to ensure that the contact resistance should always be much less than the pure. So in the case of the first approach, approach one, you are actually doing that. Why? You are essentially accumulating electrons on the interface, right? So that means if the electrons have accumulated, what will happen? So more number of electrons are on the surface. So basically the metal semiconductor junction is probably better, I mean, resistance wise. Okay, but still it is not the perfect one. So approach number two, insert large number of combination circuits, recombination circuits at the metal semiconductor interface using ion bombardment. Okay, what is this? This will turn the semiconductor side of the interface into poly. Okay, so let me explain this. Probably it's already, I mean, many of you might have understood already. So this is the case of the non-rectifying contact. So what we are going to do is we will use ion bombarding such that the region very close to, I'll just copy this so that. So if we do ion bombarding, what will happen is the region very close to the metal surface, what will happen over here? Some of the silicon bonds over here will break. Remember the concept of polysilicon, right? The grain boundaries and all that. So if the silicon bonds will break, so they will essentially generate a lot of electrons. So the whole crux of this entire making the best possible terminal contact basically boils down to making more and more electrons available on the interface. Okay, na? So that is our whole concern. So how to do that engineering part? So if you are having this poly, okay, if you are having this poly, what will happen? So many electrons will basically accumulate over here. And so the first thing was, if you simply use this phi m less than phi si, then essentially meaning that anyway the number of electrons will increase because of band bending, then how to increase it even further? How to increase the number of electrons even further? You can break the bonds on the interface, break the silicon-silicon bonds on the interface. So that will release many more electrons, free electrons on the interface. Okay, so essentially meaning that this will become even more like it is like we can't call it N plus anymore, it is like poly only. So that is a better approach. But the best approach, which is being used in modern technology, in which we are having a resistance of 10 power minus 4 ohm centimeter square, so which is like almost like metal. Not almost, it's like metal only. Okay, so how to do that? Okay. Let's understand this. Okay, everyone clear about approach one and approach two? Yeah. Huh. You can
Sir,
ask questions if you have any questions. Yeah, please.
yes, sir. Recombination center. So, if we design such that there are more recombination centers, then how will be the number of electrons will increase there?
No, recombination centers mean essentially that you are breaking the bonds. I shouldn't call it recombination centers, or basically you are having SiSi, right? Now all we are suggesting is this. So what it means is these electrons are kind of, they will essentially be free to move. So these covalent bonds are broken. Okay, so we are calling it recombination centers, like that is a technical term, which implies that these electrons can accept one hole and recombine with each other. So in this case, whenever we say that the electrons will be moving from the semiconductor to the metal, it simply means that the holes will come and recombine in the silicon region. So where will these holes come from? From the metal. Okay. Now these holes are essentially recombining at these electrons with these electrons. Okay, Ashok.
Yes, sir.
Anyone else, please clarify this because we are going to go to the latest technology immediately after this. Because approach one, you have understood that is very simple. That's basically the non-rectifying metal semiconductor contact, where we are essentially putting an N plus region at the junction. Okay. To even increase the mole number of electrons, what we do is we will break some of the bonds by ion bombarding so that effectively, I mean, I should use the word effectively here. Okay. This turns the semiconductor side into a poly. Yes, Shashank.
Sir, in ion implantation process, we will be like sending ions, right? So if suppose P plus phosphorus is sent, so effectively it will be only sending four electrons with P plus, right?
Huh, yeah.
But then we wanted one extra electron, right? Like P will have five, right?
No, what you are suggesting is that is true for making it in, I mean, the general doping of the N silicon. But how do you generate the polysilicon? Polysilicon is generated when you are doping at such a high level that it is going to convert this silicon-silicon into like the bonds will break. So remember that silicon. Okay. Okay. What you are suggesting is. If it is a substitutional impurity, there will be a phosphorus, there will be one extra. That is one extra. Okay. But if it is becoming one extra, that is how you dope this N silicon, substitutional impurity. But suppose you have doped heavily. Then it is so much of phosphorus over there that these phosphorus, in addition to creating these electrons, extra electrons, which I have shown here with the blue dots, will essentially break some of these bonds itself. Because remember, phosphorus is not crystalline. Silicon is crystalline. So agar aap itna zyada phosphorus de rahe ho, once you are adding the dopants of phosphorus to such an extent that it is effectively converting silicon into more phosphorus like, then these will bend, these will break. So what will happen? They will actually generate these will essentially become like recombination centers, right? Or that means extra electrons will be there. Got it, Shashank? So now what we are getting is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So for every bond breaking, you are essentially getting two electrons. And effectively, if you look at it, this is going to be your what? What is this green region called?
Grain
boundary. Correct. Yehi ho gaya aapka grain boundary. Got it? So this is the inner picture of the poly. Understood? Hello?
Sir, but still during ion implantation, one electron is not there with the phosphorus, right? Only ions are implanted rather than the phosphorus atom. So where does that phosphorus come, like extra electron?
Sorry? In ion implantation,
when we do phosphorus implant, we project phosphorus ions, high energy phosphorus ions.
Oh, okay. That is because if you are putting phosphorus ions, okay, those are actually in the plasma state so that they will penetrate better. That's basically nothing more than higher energy phosphorus.
Okay. But still, that does, they don't have extra electron, right? So where does they gather that extra electron, phosphorus?
Actually, whenever we are saying about the plasma, so it becomes better for the penetration. So that means if you are having, let us say this, I'm speaking in terms of MOSFET because that is the technology. So we can ensure that instead of phosphorus, if you are putting boron, so they will be penetrating much deeper. That's the whole idea. Because they are more energetic. So when we are saying that the phosphorus ions, so remember phosphorus ions, if we just insert, it doesn't always mean that all the entities are basically P plus. Okay, that means one electron deficient. Not all of them. Because if all of them are P plus, then basically you are not adding any extra electron anywhere. Okay, so ions, phosphorus ion is basically the medium so that it can penetrate. Okay, so whenever you are doing ion implantation, it's not just only phosphorus ions. Phosphorus ion is the medium which will essentially do the substitutional impurity all right, but it will not contribute anything to the extra number of electrons. But in that ions, even when you are preparing that ion in the furnace, you cannot ensure that all the phosphorus atoms have ionized. Okay. But rather what happens is those ions, if you are putting it for N plus region, then basically it becomes effective. Because if you are putting in more number of phosphorus ions only, you don't bother about these electrons anymore. But on the N plus region, what you are trying to do? You are trying to essentially break these bonds. Tab wahan par aapka, like when you are trying to make one poly, for example, annealing process mein, over there we are doing energetic phosphorus ion plasma such that these bonds will break. That is our objective. We want to create grain boundaries. So for grain creation of the grain boundaries, we don't bother about phosphorus atoms being there. But otherwise, if we are just bothered about just making it N-type silicon, then of course there will be some spurious phosphorus atoms over there. Okay, so the ionic plasma is just the medium such that they will penetrate better inside it. They will be more energetic, that's it. Got it?
Sir, like one small doubt regarding ion implantation. I actually wanted that only. Like, keeping this apart, yeah. Okay, in general ion implantation, when we generally implant for when we generally implant P plus,
generally for the fabrication of the device.
Yeah.
Okay, at that time, so the phosphorus, like, it doesn't have electron, right?
No, as I said, as I said, that if you are basically, this is a plasma. Okay, how do you create the plasma?
High temperatures, if we go very high temperatures.
Okay, now this happens when we are going, making it very high temperature. Okay, so that means converting phosphorus atoms into this phosphorus ions simply makes them more energetic, because of you are, as you are adding much more amount of heat, so basically the phosphorus ions become more energetic, so that they will penetrate better inside the silicon material. Okay, these electrons are also there, which may or may not penetrate inside the semiconductor material. That's also possible, because you are simply adding this plasma. Okay. So if you're trying to do this reversible reaction, which happens at high temperature, what you are doing is, you are actually doing it, you are getting advantageous in two different aspects. Number one, this P plus ions, they can basically penetrate inside silicon wafer. Okay. And these P plus ions, they will not contribute any separate electrons. What they will do is, they will do substitutional impurity, but correct, they will break the bonds. So that means they are making it more and more. But I'll say it's not a very good grain boundary, because it is not, a grain is not everywhere. It's not poly as of now.
So like, will this talk about normal,
if it is normal, if it is just normal, like 10 power 16, 10 power 17 kind of doping, in that case, even though we are doing P plus plasma, it's not, I mean, in fact, the amount of P plus plasma is there. How much of this reaction has happened, like how much of phosphorus atoms has converted into P plus ion, is also controlled by the heat and the temperature of this plasma. So you can have like 10 power 16 P atoms, and let us say 10 power 20 P plus. Or maybe less, say 10 power 4 P plus ions. So that means this reversal has happened at a higher temperature when we are creating this P plus ion plasma, but that is only 10 power 4. This is 10 power 16. So the total phosphorus content over here is 10 power 20 per centimeter cube, all of them. Got it? So out of 10 power 20, only 10 power 4 has converted to P plus and electrons, whereas the rest of the 10 power 16 is still remaining phosphorus. So now if you put this as a plasma, what happens is, thanks to this ionic plasma, the phosphorus will be too energetic and it will essentially penetrate inside. But only those phosphorus atoms which are, I mean, in atomic state, only they will generate those extra one electrons.
So you essentially mean that only, even though we ionize that entire thing,
because when we are saying that we are ionizing this entire thing, means we cannot practically ionize the entire thing. Okay, there will definitely be, this ionization happens at a higher temperature. So we are simply energizing those phosphorus atoms and as well as the ions to essentially get inside. But effectively, the substitutional impurity will create the doping only because of this phosphorus. This reaction should happen inside silicon, not in the plasma. Please understand that. When we say that the phosphorus atoms have ionized inside silicon, making it n-type. Okay, so how do you do about that? How do you go about that? These electrons are essentially kind of, you know, detached from the phosphorus atom, right? How do you go about that? The only way you can do it is how? That means phosphorus is chosen, remember, because its ionization energy is less than the thermal energy, remember? So that means this reaction should happen inside the silicon wafer in order to make it n-type. These electrons, they should not be lost in the plasma. They should be there inside phosphorus, inside silicon material. Tabhi to wo electron conduction band mein jayega, right? So whenever we are making it as a plasma, you cannot ensure that, okay, the entire phosphorus is into P plus. Okay. So we will just complete this. Prithviraj, are you convinced?
Yes, sir. Yes,
oh, yeah, sir. Yeah. Now we will go to the best approach. This is what makes the contact terminals, terminal contacts in modern technology. What we will do is, this is in silicon, this whole thing, control C, control V. Oh, sorry. I'll draw it here itself. Now, okay. Okay, this was the original situation. Now, in the modern approach, let's read this. We will insert a very low resistance layer with heavy doping, which will induce both thermionic field emission and field emission. Okay, let's understand what does that mean. Okay, so here is the scenario, but instead of that, we will put one. I mean, I have exaggerated it a lot, but this is the kind of generalization of what is going on here. Okay, and then remember, this is the level which we had initially, right? Instead, what we will do is, where was the EF? Oh, that EF is gone. EF was somewhere here, right? Now the EF remains unchanged because it is under thermal equilibrium, right? Now, from between here, between this NSI and metal, we will put one heavily doped N plus region. We can either put it like this, but this is an exaggeration. Usually this will be, EC will be very close to EF itself. But anyway, it's easier for us to understand. And then where does this EC come over here? That will depend on, this variation. So in the previous case, what we did, I mean, for approach one and approach two, we had been using the situation where phi m was greater than phi si. So this was also for here also, remember. Phi m is greater than phi si. Now, whenever we are putting it n plus region here, so n plus means where is the effective, when it was not under contact, then this EFM is going to be lower. EF will be lower than EFM. Okay, so this region will also get shifted. Okay, let me show the new. Here, this is also getting shifted. So from here, then this is also getting shifted lower, and then it will go and attach it like that. Okay. So now let us see what the magic is happening. So previously we had seen that the phi bi was given by that, right? So if the phi bi is here, so it will essentially be a very, very thin layer which goes on like that. Okay, so in this case, look, so what are the various activities which we are doing? Previously, we had accumulated more electrons on the interface. How did we accumulate more electrons? That was thermionic emission only. That means thermal generation. Okay, so this thermionic emission, look, those electrons are there itself. But now, these electrons will not stay here because there is no junction. It is just N plus region. So these electrons will essentially, all of them will accumulate in this region. So there will, this region will be full of electrons. At the same time, it is heavily doped. Now, what is the catch? What is the main advantage? So this part over here, like this generation, so these electrons coming over here and getting accumulated in this kind of a well kind of structure is because of thermionic emission, TE. Okay. That's because of doping levels only, band bending and doping level, standard ones, whichever we have seen over here. Now, once the electrons have accumulated here, now if you notice that this is a metal, and over here we are having a huge number of electrons which are accumulated on this side. So what does it happen? On the surface, you will now notice only a few nanometers thickness, you are having a small barrier, so they will start tunneling inside. Okay, so this tunneling is called thermionic field emission. Okay, so the combination of this thermionic emission and this thermionic field emission. So thermionic field emission, a standard word for this is tunneling. Thermionic emission, standard word for this is simply the band bending. Okay, so these two combinations will essentially affect in a very good terminal contact whose resistance will be in this order. Now, this, then you are thinking about that if there is a tunneling, then shouldn't it give you a rise to a resistance or something? Now, here is the catch. How come it is providing you such an excellent value of the resistance? The reason is, always remember, tunneling phenomenon doesn't happen with the expense of energy. Okay. Tunneling phenomenon is independent of energy. So that means the electrons which are here having X number of electron volt will be tunneling to this part having X number of electron volt. Okay. Whereas the electron which is here, if it has X amount of electron volt, once it comes here, how much electron does it have? X minus this Gibbs free energy. Remember, I discussed this during our quantum mechanics classes. Okay, so tunneling phenomenon is an energy independent process, an energy independent phenomenon. In fact, we have seen tunneling happening in case of saturation also, pinch off region, remember? So in the pinch off region, we have seen that within that small region of space, it is simply shooting itself. Okay, so this is what is the phenomenon. So this is an ideal contact. And this is basically your Q5EI. Yes. Yes, so, Ashok.
Here we have taken N plus.
Yeah.
So anyway, the starting thing is like phi m less than phi si. So the band bending should be like the previous case, right? I mean,
this N plus region is chosen such that over here, here for the choice of this N plus is basically the previous one. Okay. So over here, this semiconductor, you are going to have phi m like this, less than phi si, because phi m being less than phi si will ensure this thermionic emission. But this thermionic field emission is possible when phi m is greater than phi si. So this small region of heavily doped material, that can be a poly, that can be, but in the previous case, in approach number two, we were simply bombarding the material just to make it as a poly. But here we are essentially creating a thin layer of it. So that is why I said in modern technology, it is possible. 50 years ago, these were the only ways which you can make an ohmic contact. That's the reason why in Streetman or Niemann textbook, which were written in 1970s, 80s, over there, you will find this as the ohmic contact. In modern technology, we are actually using this, where the fabrication technology is such that you can literally make 2 to 3 nanometer layer of a different material. Okay.
Regarding that ion implantation part, so the ions that are acting as a plasma, they are just the path to
insert, to penetrate. Insert. That's it.
Plasma, so they are not going into.
No. Plasma is basically the flux, let us say. It is the medium. Medium is the best way.
And sir, so while selecting the dosage of the concentration or dose, so we have to keep in mind about the plasma ions also, right? I
mean, yeah, sure. We have to always keep in mind, like, how much of phosphorus you actually want to get inside. Accordingly, you will increase the temperature for that reaction to happen. Okay. Suppose you want to ensure that you are trying to get one polysilicon only. So what will you do? Or N plus region in the source drain. Over there, you literally require very, very high number of electrons. So what you will do is rather make it completely P plus. Okay, so we will increase the plasma. So the plasma energy will be even more higher, such that all the phosphorus atoms will be converted into phosphorus ions. And you are essentially trying to break the bonds than use only the single electrons out of the phosphorus atoms. Okay. So plasma is something which is used for ion implantation everywhere, whether you want lesser doping or higher doping or even polysilicon, because plasma is the medium by which you are inserting those atoms or ions inside the material. Okay. So how much of that plasma will contain phosphorus atoms and how much will be the ions, that is under your control. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. So that's all for today. Thank you so much for joining. In our next class, we will begin with SOI. Okay. Thank you.